So thank you, Hans, for inviting me to speak today. I'd like to discuss a little bit and tell you a little about the technology we've been developing at Jola for digital color holographic printing, particularly using pulsed lasers. So the technology that we've used to produce these types of display over here. So I'd like to talk to start with about what is a one and two-step digital holographic printer, why we use pulse lasers in the first place, then the design of the type of printers that we and XYZ are using, and the lasers that we use in them. And then I'd like to talk a little bit about some improvements we've made to the laser technology, particularly with reference to short cavity pulsed lasers. Then I'd like to also discuss a new type of printer that we're testing at the moment, which is based on the LCOS display technology. Then also I'd like to come to the topic of copying holograms, because obviously when you write a hologram pixel by pixel, like we do over here, even with a pulsed laser, it takes rather a long time. And probably I won't have time to talk about the work we've done today also on high-energy pulsed lasers. Usually you need relatively small energies to produce these types of holograms because the pixel size is small. But for some applications and some schemes, you need higher energy lasers. We have been working on that. So this is a general scheme of the type of holographic printer that we've been developing. It can be used to make what we call a one-step hologram, which is, I guess, like this. Or it can also be used to make a variety of master holograms from which you then copy using a variety of schemes to produce a final hologram. So basically we have three pulse lasers, a red, this is more difficult than it looks like with this mouse, red pulse laser, green pulse laser, and blue pulse laser. We basically split each one of these beams using beam splitters into a reference beam arm, which then goes through some conditioning optics and is then brought to bear on a holographic film. And also, of course, an object beam, which goes through, again, some conditioning. And then we use an LCD to imprint digital data on that object beam, a high numerical aperture objective to focus down to produce a little 1 millimeter by 1 millimeter pixel at the same point where you have the impinging reference beam. And then that causes a grating to form on the holographic film. And of course, then we have a film advance system, which allows us to advance the film in two dimensions. And then, of course, we have exactly the same thing for the red, the green, and the blue, and all of the pixels then finally overlap. So that's the basic scheme that we're talking about. When we think about copying, because you can make a master hologram or a final hologram like that, when we think about copying, then we think that we make a master hologram and we've got to make a final copy from it. So we have various types of copies we can make from this type of technology. So on this diagram, we have the green or turquoise plate is the master, and then obviously the red is the unexposed film that you're going to make the copy on, and you just use a contacts copying scheme, typically with a pulse laser. So typically the master is a reflection hologram, and you need a low energy scanning RGB laser beam to do that. On two over here, you can also make what we call a close copy. So again, you make a different type of master with digital data on it, and you copy at a slight distance, using usually an aperture. And you can all, you'll probably know then the scheme of copying, which is called H1, H2, where you make a master, and then at a large distance, which corresponds to the viewing distance of the hologram, you make the copy. And typically, when you're talking about RGB holography, you want a reflection master, and you need a higher energy RGB laser, which is one of the reasons we've been doing work also on high energy RGB lasers. So that's a typical holographic printer. This particular one is the one we use in Vilnius to print holograms, and has been used to print that one. It's made by XYZ Imaging, which is in Montreal, Canada, which is our company that we span out about 4 or 5 years ago. Could just, hold on a sec. So it's comprised of a main optical unit where you have the pulse laser and all the optics. Obviously the computer control, underneath are all the power supplies for the laser, etc. And then on this side there's a film advance unit where you have a film carriage which can move from left to right, and the actual film is on rollers and a vacuum tensioning system which brings it up and down. That's another holographic printer that we produced in Jola in, I think, 2001. Identical optical scheme as the previous one, except really the only thing which is different is that instead of a film advance system, we use a glass plate. So typically this system could use a meter by meter glass plate, and then you can write holograms onto glass coated materials. So why use pulse lasers and not use CW lasers? Well, the obvious reason is freedom from vibration, particularly when you talk about the one-step printers or making a master. When you print at a fast speed using a pulse laser, maybe say 60 holographic pixels a second, even with a small pixel size like we have over here, you have to move the film fast. And given the fact that you need a micron resolution to your interference pattern, you can work out that you need exposure times which are under a microsecond. So it's not very efficient to use a CW laser at the best of times, because obviously the energy would have to be, or the power would have to be very large, and then you just shutter it for a very, very small period of time. So you have the motion of the film, which ultimately provides a constraint, also the vibration. If you think of copiers, then it depends. Intrinsically, perhaps you don't need to use pulsed lasers. It depends whether you overlap the pixels or the area that you're copying. So in a contact copier, for example, you can use a slit or a spot, and sometimes the spots can be juxtaposed, sometimes they can be overlapped. If they're strongly overlapped, then you have the problem of the interference patterns adding up coherently or incoherently, and generally you want to keep the thing stable, whether or not you use a pulsed laser. Then, in this case, so for the case of strongly overlapping pixels, you pick pulsed lasers simply because they're useful devices which happen to have the correct wavelengths, the same wavelengths that you've made the master at. If they're not strongly overlapped, as in some copying schemes, then vibration obviously is a strong constraint, and using a pulsed laser gets you over that. Particularly for the H1, H2 scheme, where you've got the master and the copy at a very large distance, you're potentially very sensitive to vibration, and using a pulsed laser can be a great benefit. So the type of printers we're using at the moment are based on what we call long cavity pulsed laser technology. So this is an old photo of a RGB pulsed laser that we made probably in 2001. But the lasers which we're using at the moment are very similar. Repetition rate, something like 30 hertz. Energy is approximately 3 millijoules at each color. The colors are 440, 532, 660 nanometers. And pulse lengths, which are typically 40 to 50 nanoseconds. This type of technology by itself has a less than ideal stability, pulse-to-pulse stability, and you generally need active stabilization of the cavity length to get sufficient stability so that you don't get horrible black pixels when you print some of these holograms. The LCD technology that we use in the current printers is the standard twisted pneumatic LCDs. One of the problems it has is it's limited to around 30 hertz repetition rate, and then you have to heat to around 50 degrees centigrade to get that sort of repetition rates from it. And these panels that we use are relatively inefficient. I'd like to just talk a little bit more in detail of the current design that we use for a holographic printer. And basically to show how it can be used to make the different forms of holograms, be master holograms or one-step holograms. So when we designed this, we called it a universal or dual-mode holographic printer because the same holographic printer could be switched to produce transmission holograms, reflection holograms, one-step holograms, rainbow holograms, H1, H2, etc., etc. In each case, the digital data was transformed and the geometry of the recording was changed a little bit. But just to go over really briefly, this diagram shows just the green channel, let's say. Generally, we stack the green, the red, and the blue one on top of the other, and they have pretty much identical optical schemes. So here is a green pulse laser going through a beam splitter, forming a reference beam, and a reference beam. The reference beam can be directed either as a beam which comes from the opposite side of the holographic film, in which case you have a reflection hologram, or it can be directed around here to the same side of the holographic film, in which case you have a transmission hologram. The object beam comes down here into a telescope, and we use a lens array, a micro lens array here, which we specially design to basically, it does a few things, including choose the pixel size of the hologram, and also to condition the microstructure of the individual holographic pixel at the holographic film. So, hold on, I've lost my cursor. Where is it? This is the LCD, so basically the beam comes through the lens array, and the axial rays from the lens array will then be collimated by this lens, illuminate an LCD, which for certain types of hologram needs to be moved in a two-dimensional fashion in synchronization with the film. For other types of hologram, it doesn't. And then it goes downstream through polarizer and into a high numerical aperture lens, which we design especially for each of the different colors. This film, obviously, I've said before on the other diagram, it's made to move in a two-dimensional fashion. It can also be moved with certain rollers so that the angle with respect to the axial ray in the object beam can be changed. So going on, this is another view of it from the side. So you can see clearly the LCD here, polarizer going through the high NA lens, being focused down onto a pixel. And here again, a detail where you see the lens focusing the rays down, and where we've put the film plane downstream of the Fourier plane, so that the reference beam is actually now quite large. And we would use this technique, for example, typically in creating a transmission master hologram, where we would strongly overlap the pixels. This would be another scheme. For example, when we have a reference beam from the opposite side of the film, there we create a reflection hologram. But again, when the film is downstream. And again, we create a relatively strongly overlapped set of holographic pixels. And this is this would be suitable for an H1, H2 copy in reflection. Now, if we were making an H1, H2 copy, we could also change the density in the vertical and the horizontal directions, for example. We could also make transmission masters using just one color, in fact, so you don't need an RGB laser for this. And you can make rainbow holograms, and you can pull the film into an angle so you can get the achromatic angle. Alternatively, you can use a one-step system. So here, this would be the scheme that we use for this hologram, where you have the reference beam coming from the opposite side, so it's a reflection hologram. And this time, the emulsion is just a little bit downstream of the Fourier plane. So you get a smaller pixel, and you tend not to overlap the pixels, simply because you want to use it as a one-step final hologram, and so you don't want to diminish the diffraction efficiency by averaging the holograms. So you write a plurality of pixels which are juxtaposed rather than overlapped. Going on to the type of lasers that we use, I don't know if you can see this. Some of the figures are small, but this would be a modern laser that we'd use in the current printers. It's basically a neodymium YAG laser, which is built out of twin cavities. One oscillates at 1064 nanometers, and we frequency double that to 532 nanometers. The other is a YAG laser, which is oscillating at 1319 nanometers. Now, the cross-section for the 1319 nanometer line is rather smaller than the 1064, but you can inhibit the 1064 quite easily from lasing, and so you can then double and triple to produce 660 and 440. And this produces a nice scheme for producing an RGB laser. Generally, we use a linear cavity. For example, here we have two end mirrors, an end mirror, an output coupler, and the crystal here. These lenses are lamp pumped, generally. And we have several frequency selective elements within the cavity to ensure the temporal coherence is what you want, and also the energy stability. Of course, they're passively Q-switched, so we use saturable absorbers. And the 1319 laser is very similar to the 1064 laser. So you can see that, if I can find my cursor again, looking at the green laser, the output comes out of the output coupler, generally is then focused through a KTP crystal, producing 532, and then the beam is collimated. In the 1319 nanometer laser, we use a doubling and tripling crystal appropriate for those wavelengths, and we produce red and blue. The quality of the beam is really good because during the nonlinear conversion, you focus down to a very small size, so you have natural diffractive cleaning. Looking at the sort of parameters that we get around 4 millijoules. You can see here's actually one laser that we made. I just took this from our manual, and we measured 4.86 in the red, 3.48 in the blue, and 6 in the green. You can see that without active stabilization, the stabilities are not too good. If you can look at the third line down, it's in some point plus or minus 10%, which is not so great when you want to write a hologram like that. So one of the things which is really important is to actively stabilize, or actually passively or actively stabilize, the laser cavity. And just here, I draw a graph of energy versus time over a 10 to 16 hour period, where we look at the output of the laser. And when we apply stabilization, you see you have a very good signal, which is quite appropriate for writing holograms. A minute you stop stabilization, you get mode bursts. These type of lasers are characterized by mode bursts. So they have frequency selective elements in them, and the optical path length of the laser cavity can change. So generally what we do is there are several different techniques, but in Jola we tend to use a heated rear mirror. whereby we have a cylindrical aluminium tube, which we heat to a very accurate fashion, and we put our end mirror on the end of that. So as we heat this cylinder, the end mirror will move by some very small distance. If we plot that rear mirror temperature here, which is equivalent to the cavity length, versus the standard deviation in energy, you see that you have this sort of natural shape. You have some minima, and you have some maxima. And you really want light to sit in this minimum region. You can also plot the energy versus the cavity length, and you can see that it's the inverse curve. So you can actually look at the energy of this laser, and it tells you where it wants to be and what it's doing. And so you can, of course, make a mathematical algorithm with a computer to change the temperature of the rear mirror and then track. And so, for example, you see over this period here where we stabilized it, generally the temperature is being changed like this. So there's probably no need to show you examples of these holograms because you've seen plenty today and in the coffee room. But of course, Jola and XYZ have done quite a few campaigns with advertising agencies and stuff using this technology of one-step printing. And generally, you can get very high, relatively high quality results. So that's where we are today, printing at 30 hertz. So a hologram like this takes about 6 hours to print generally if you use a 1.8 millimeter, a 1.6 millimeter pixel, and around 24 hours if you use a 0.8 millimeter pixel. Obviously, we want to improve that. Also, the current technology today is rather, as I said, it's a little bit unstable, and you need to actively stabilize the lasers in order to make them behave well. If you make too much noise around your printer, it will miss pixels. So it would be nice to stabilize and to improve the laser technology. One of the ideas we had with this, which we feel is very promising and we're starting to do work on it, is generally reducing the size of the laser. So the long cavity lasers basically have a cavity length of so big. What we started to do now is to make them around this large. And this is a commercial laser which we made, and I include it just for reference, really, to show you the size. This laser is approximately the same size as our RGB lasers. So it's around a meter long. The resonators themselves are around a meter long. So the resonator, both resonators, would sit in like this and fill up pretty much the whole of the laser. And the nonlinear conversion optics would sit in the middle. We've now gone down to a laser which is this size, around 120 millimeters long, and that then produces the 1064 nanometers and 1319 nanometers. Of course, you'd need two of those oscillators. That's a detail showing you the actual pump chamber for the lamp. And if I remove on this drawing the pump chamber, you see just the 65 millimeter crystal of neodymium YAG here, and you see the sort of scheme that we're using, which is fairly much identical to the long cavity laser. It's an Alper coupler, which also happens to be an Etalon. You have a high reflection rear mirror, polarizer, Q switch, and some wave plates to stop spatial hole burning since it's a linear cavity. So very similar to the design of the long cavity lasers using very similar crystals and stuff. Of course, it produces less energy. This is a little scheme showing you how we do the nonlinear conversion. Again, it's identical. A crystal of KTP with various telescopes, and you get 532 nanometers. Generally, we can get 400 microjoules per pulse. In comparison to the old technology, the long cavity lasers of 3 millijoules, say, per pulse. It's easy to get this thing to work at 60 hertz. It's easy to get it to work at higher. Typically, you could go to maybe 120 hertz with this lamped pump technology without too much problem. Because it's smaller, it's much more rigid, and so generally the optical path length stays much better fixed. So YAG has a thermal lens The old lasers, you have to optimize the laser for a particular frequency of repetition. These, you can just tune them. It's easy because the geometry is less stringent because it's smaller. So generally, the kind of stabilities that we can get is for millions of pulses, we can get better than plus or minus 3%. That's a typical realization of the blue or the red channel. So you can produce exactly the same way red. Typically, we can get 450 microjoules per pulse, and we've demonstrated this up to 60 hertz, same stabilities. And you can also make a red and a blue, whereby you get the red and the blue from the single 1319, or you can make just the blue. So typically, if you run it in just the blue mode, where you try to get all of your 1319 to be converted to 440, then you can get around 250 microjoules per pulse. So the type of stabilization systems we use for these short cavity lasers are a little different from the long cavity lasers. And this is illustrated by this graph here. Again, this is the temperature of the rear mirror mount. And as we scan the temperature of the rear mirror mount, we can plot the standard deviation of the output energy. And you see you have very, very stable operation followed by very abrupt onset of unstable operation. And it's more difficult to actively stabilize a laser like this because, in fact, the laser just doesn't tell you what it's doing. It's working fine, and then if the laser drifts into an unstable region, it will simply, from the first pulse, start behaving badly. So generally, how we stabilize these lasers is we surround them by a metal surface on which we completely control the temperature. And then, assuming you don't have any heat sources within the volume, you know that the temperature at any point within that surface is constant. So we can maintain the volume temperature very accurately. Then, if before we write a hologram, we make a scan, as we show on this graph, you can simply position the laser in, say, for example, this position here, and it will sit there for hours and hours and hours and hours and tens of millions of pulses. Like this, for example, where you can see a lot of pulses over 15 hours, and there's not one single pulse which is outside the limit of plus or minus 4% PTP. It's worth saying just a little bit about the performance of these lasers, because generally the smaller that you make the laser, the shorter the pulse you would expect to come out of it. And these silver halide emulsions are generally much more sensitive to pulse lengths over 30 nanoseconds. You go under 30 nanoseconds, depending on wavelength, then the diffraction efficiency that you can get tends to drop. So it's a great concern to try and get something like 40, 50 nanoseconds out of these laser systems. And the first worry is squashing the whole thing down would just get you into the 10 nanosecond regime, so it wouldn't be very useful. However, we see that what you can do is you can change the output coupler reflectivity, which is more or less useful, but more importantly, you can actually change the initial transmission of the saturable absorbers within the cavity. And so, for example, looking at this graph here, we go from 30 nanoseconds up to over 150 nanoseconds as we change the initial transmission of the saturable absorber. Of course, as you change the initial transmission of the saturable absorber and you get a longer pulse, you pay a price for that, and that's that the energy goes down. So, for example, if you look at this graph over here, we can start off with around 8 millijoules. This is at 1064 nanometers for a 20% initial transmission. And as we go up to the 80% region, which would give us near 100 nanoseconds output pulse, then we're going down to around 1 millijoule. Nevertheless, you don't need much energy for holograms like this. So 1 millijoule, it's not such a problem. you can actually go further than this, and you can say, well, why do we want to use lamps in the first place? Why not go to diode pumping? And I guess the answer to that is that if you need more energy, then lamps are relatively inexpensive, and they're a good way to get more energy. If you need less energy and you need higher repetition rates, then diodes are arguably a good solution. Over 200 hertz, perhaps you'd say you want to go to diodes. So with that in mind, we've been developing diode systems based on exactly the same architecture. Here, for example, is a laser that we are working on at the moment. Typical cavity length is around 90 millimeters. So it's a small thing around this big. Pumped with a CW laser diode. These are the collimation optics. The diode radiation would come through a fiber optic, which plugs in just here. And this is a better view of the whole thing. You can see here the 808 nanometer diode radiation would come in and would be focused into the neodymium YAG crystal, which could also be, for example, vanadate as well. You have a very similar layout. You have a rear mirror, this time coated in a slightly different way to transmit 808 and to reflect, say, 1319, and output coupler, polarizer, exactly the same stuff. And generally, you can get around about 100 microjoules of 1319 out of that, 50 nanosecond pulses in the kilohertz regime. So those are the sort of innovations in the laser part of the technology that we're trying to make at the moment. But it's also very important to pair this up with the new panel technology which is available. As you all know, LCOS displays now are really providing a revolution in displays. They have better performance than their LCD cousins. You can get around 71% efficiency, reflective efficiency. They can work at much higher repetition rates. As I said before, the LCD panels worked up to 30 hertz in our printers if you really try hard and you heat them. With these panels, you can go up to 60 hertz easily, and probably 120, and even more probably with the latest panels from Sony, up to 200 hertz. So that really helps you a lot in writing a hologram like this, if you can make the writing time smaller. Also, it's interesting because the efficiency of these panels is better, contrast ratio better, you get better holograms, and you need less energy. And that fits in very nicely with using short cavity lasers and diode pumped lasers. So we have a demonstration system which we're working on at the moment, which is an RGB printer which is working at 60 holographic pixels per second. And potentially we wish to upgrade this to 120 pixels. It's based on the display from Brillion, called the BR768HC. And you can see the type of panels you have there. The type of printer that we now have to design is a little bit different, and it's worth just going through the sort of changes. This is again for one color channel. You have a green laser here, or it could be red or blue, and it splits it through a beam splitter into a reference beam, which goes around here, and it splits it into an object beam, which goes around here. This lot is just to make the reference path length equal to the object path length. And then it goes into the standard lens array system that we talked about before. But then you have to change a little bit because you need to make very specialized, a specialized optical system in order to use these reflective panels. So generally you need an afocal telecentric reversing system using a McNeil polarizer with the LCOS displays coupled with the high numerical aperture objective to do this. And that's just a detail of that system there, and that's a ray trace of it showing the McNeil polarizer where your light comes in and is going to the LCOS display, being reflected back, and then is being brought to the high NA lens and then made into a pixel at this point here. That's another detail of the type of optics that we're using. And then going back to copies, because copying is very important, because even if you write these holograms very quickly, they're not quick enough. As I said before, this hologram takes around 6 hours to make. If we go to 60 hertz, it will take 3 hours to make, 120, 1.5 hours. It's still a long time, and the printers are, of course, quite expensive. So generally, when you go to advertising clients, they want to have hundreds, thousands of these holograms, and very quickly. So how do you do that? It's useful to make master holograms quickly as using this technology, and the printers will be smaller and cheaper. But you still have a problem. You can't get those speeds. You can't make something work probably at 10 kilohertz with this technology. Or at least I can't see how to do it. So it's important to talk about copies. So I bring up the slide that I had before, which is the types of copy that you can use, the contact copy, the closed copy, or the H1, H2 copy. We've been working on both the contact copy and also the H1, H2 copy. The H1, H2 copy, of course, needs a lot more energy. And generally, panchromatic materials are not so sensitive as the old monochromatic materials. So you need joules of energy. So we haven't fully explored that yet, and we haven't got joules in the red and the blue as yet, although we have hundreds of millijoules. So our present target for copying is more the contact copier, and I'd just like to say a few words on the type of experiments we've been doing with contact copying. So this is a schematic version of contact copier using a long cavity RGB laser. So the laser is typically in this box here with optics, and then we put our film to be copied in this box. We can use a slit or we can use a spot scanning method. This particular set of diagrams shows a spot scanning method that we've investigated. You can probably see here better the white laser beam coming out of the box and then hitting a sandwich, which is composed of a master hologram, which is basically a tuned version of that hologram, so that you don't have any collapse of the emulsion. It replays at exactly the right laser wavelengths. And then you basically put the unexposed hologram plate on top of it, film on top of it, and then scan in a two-dimensional fashion. Now, you can do that with a slit as well, and I'll report here some results from the slit scanning that we've done. So the types of energy that we use are written up here. We're copying a 30 by 20 centimeter hologram, tuned to these wavelengths very carefully. And then afterwards, the copy is shifted down 20 nanometers to be more visible and color corrected. Slit widths are about 15 millimeters. And we plot here the time to write the entire hologram versus the relative efficiency to the master. And you can see that I won't deal with the form of these graphs, which are statistically significant, by the way. But as you increase the time, you also increase the overlaps, because you're overlapping the slits at each time. And the diffraction efficiency generally progresses the more you overlap. And you can see from the green, you're getting up to near 100%. The red is slightly less, and the blue slightly less. This is making a coincident white slit, so you record all the holograms at the same time. You can also plot this as an overlap versus the relative efficiency. And basically, the results are the following, that with a white slit, with a tuned master, you can get around 50 to 70% average diffraction efficiency, relative efficiency. which is a little bit less than what you need, really, commercially. We'd like to get 110% or so. But if you use a single color, you can get up to 300%. So there's a big difference there. If you use timed copying, so you first use a slit with red, then green, then blue, you can get to nearly 90%. So you can get pretty commercial results. Interesting, if you do it in the opposite direction, I think we've heard this already in this conference from several people. If you do it in the opposite direction and you use blue first, you do not get such a good result at all. So if you copy with blue first, typically we're getting 50 to 60% efficiencies. So regarding Jola's technology, copying with a pulse laser, I'm coming to conclusions now, Hans, is almost at a commercial level. And we expect really commercial results very, very soon. But one thing that we would, and we are trying, we would like to try and we are trying, is using a double layer emulsion. Because if we can put the two gratings, we can have two gratings separately, we feel we can get that extra diffraction efficiency, which will make the difference then of copying these types of holograms effectively. You can copy them then very, very quickly, say a few minutes potentially for a hologram like this. And if you can get the quality good and the diffraction efficiency good, then we see a large market for that. And that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. I assume we may have some questions. Are there any?
How are you defining diffraction efficiency? How are you defining diffraction efficiency that you're getting 300% diffraction efficiency?
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's a loose definition. I mean, what we're doing is we're measuring the brightness of the hologram using essentially a power meter. So we're measuring the power that we get in a... We set up a system which illuminates the hologram. We measure then the power we get from the replay on the master and then on the copy, and we divide the two. So it's a ratio of the replay powers, if you like. So when I say 300%, it means that the power that you get when you replay the final copy is three times greater than the same, in the same geometry, replay system on the master. Yes. Professor Seinert? Please.
Do you blend these two layers emulsion for your master to be the same thickness as a single layer, about 8 microns? So if you need to have some advantages,
yes,
it's easy to calculate. The thickness of your double layers emulsion for blue, green, and red separately, the thickness will be at least two times more than initial thickness of Slavic materials. But in 16 microns thickness, it will be very difficult to obtain the same result in developing procedure. Also, the optimum for silver halide layers is 8 microns, well known. So my question is about the thickness of your new materials.
Yeah, that's obviously a very good question. And it's not the first time that we've tried double-layer emulsions. We've tried in the past to produce them. And when we were producing the original PFG 3CN emulsion for these projects, we were very hopeful to get a double-layer emulsion. And it didn't work as well as we thought it would work. However, we probably spent too little time on that. So what we're doing now is we will try and do a variety of different tests. One of the things that I think we feel is that you can do theoretical calculations on all of these things. So there are a number of variables, and it's difficult to say what's going to work at the end. When we produced the first panchromatic material, it was very empirical. It was trying this, trying that. It wasn't some mathematical calculation. So point taken. But our approach will be to try several different batches, several thicknesses, etc., and see if we can get some better results.
We can continue, but before we do that, the next speaker is ready, and you want to use your own computer. So in the meantime, when you set it up, if you come and use this microphone, we can take some more questions. There was a question from...
If you use double layer devices, have you any preference for sensitization, chemical spectral sensitization? So one must be red, the other one green or blue, or it is an inversion situation?
We'll be thinking of using two layers, one for blue-green and one for blue-red. Of course, yes. If I've understood your question correctly.
Two questions. First is, is it possible to use simple diode lasers to do this work, to do this printing work? Not the pulsed laser, just a very cheap that diode laser. Okay, this is the first question. The second question is, what's the difference you have just described to us? And the printers. One is the three-color printer separate, print the whole image. The second is the three-color printers, the three-color lasers combined together to print it. What's the difference?
Okay. Well, to answer the first question, yeah, I think the issue is you're asking if you can use a small CW laser to do this. And yeah, the problem is that with CW lasers you have vibration, and also that you move your film rapidly. If you want to make dot matrix or these type of holograms very rapidly. Yeah, I mean, in principle, you can do that. You just have to take a long time to do it. And you can do contact copying, of course, with CW lasers. So perhaps I would say that the diode lasers are more useful for CW in the copying, because there, generally, you want to overlap your slits, which means that you need interferometric stability. But because the copy and the master are so close together, it's very stable anyway. So CW lasers are very useful. You don't need much energy. But for writing this type of master, I'd say it's not so useful. Yeah. I think maybe we'll talk, because Hans is saying we should close the...
Yeah, I think what we can have some more questions at the end of the session, if we have time before lunch, for all the speakers, because I will... Thank you very much for this interesting on the pulse RGB laser.